So once Johnny here, I'm gonna let you in a little secret.
We got an intent.
Shh. Oh, dude, I'm Tom.
Oh, what's up, John?
No, never mind. Just on my way back into the Viewmaster's Edge.
Hey, that's cool. But watch out, dude. It's a lot of dangerous stuff in there.
Hey, come on, what can happen to me? I'll see you later.
Okay.
Oh, fuck, the door was open.
She, I'm not there, you fuck.
Hey guys, welcome to Video Masters TV. I'm John, and you're watching the episode for March 2011. This has been quite a month. It's seen the release of the Nintendo 3DS in North America, Europe, and Australia. Japan got first dibs just last month. And speaking of Japan, I know you guys are well aware that the folks over in Japan are going through a tough time right now. A big earthquake and tsunami hit, a great deal of lives were lost, and, you know, one of our own has family over in Japan, our own Matt Rao. And I hope you guys who are watching the show keep your friend and mine in your prayers, all right? I appreciate it. So, hey, listen, we got a show to put out. Lots of great stuff awaits you in this episode. So, what do you say we lighten the mood with a little bit of wine and comics? Let's check it out.
This, House of Secrets, issue number 92. I got this off eBay. This is the first ever look and introduction to, who's that guy back there? The Swamp Thing. Okay, you wanna look at it really quick with me? Let's look at it really quick. This is a very old comic. It smells even better than all the others. Because it's from 1971. It's from the year that I was born, if you can believe that shit. Okay? I mean, look how decrepit this comic has gotten. And this is the low end on the comic grade, because I could not afford the higher grade. Right here. This cell is the first ever. See that guy? That's the Swamp Thing, right? Am I wrong? Am I right? That is the first ever visual, besides the cover, of course, of the Swamp Thing. I cannot remember the morning anymore, but I know the evening well. I belong to it now, and it cares for me in return, sheltering me, nurturing me. Holding me close within its velvet embrace. The moon is rising now, clawing its way into the sky. A glowing amber eye that casts its disdainful gaze on the murky ooze below. The swamp that is my home. I move slowly through the moss-draped mire. Treading a path that is worn smooth from my constant passing. This guy's been here a while. On beyond the shadows and the dark trees, twisting tendrils to my inevitable destination. Well, his destination is his girlfriend. He's shacked up in a house with some rich guy. And he wants to destroy that rich guy, and he crashes through the glass in front of the house to grab the guy. But of course, he's the Swamp Thing, transformed from a man who was once her boyfriend, lover, whatever. Do I make any sense now? I don't think so. Anyway, I think that's it for this episode of Wine and Comics. I don't know how to end it very well other than saying, watch the rest of the episode, folks. Later. Bye.
Hey there. Now that you're able to play as Sir Arthur in the new Marvel vs. Capcom 3 game, I thought it was only fitting to take a trip back in time to Arthur's SNES adventure, Super Ghouls and Ghosts. Here's a sweet stage select cheat. Alright, in the title screen, enter the options mode, and hit select until exit is highlighted. Now pick up controller 2 and hold button L, select, and start. While you've got these buttons held, press start on controller 1. This will switch you over to the special screen where you can select your starting stage and level, as well as taking a few tunes with the sound test, if you're into that kind of thing. Many people won't recognize this game. This is Keith Courage and Alpha Zones for the TurboGrafx-16. This was a pack-in for the system, and in this game, you're traversing through overworld and underworld stages, and the underworld stages aren't just a simple romp. So to ease your frustration, here's a debug menu for you. Before the title screen becomes fully visible, take your controller and hold button 1, button 2, select, and run. Now wait to see the word start appear. While holding all these buttons down, press up 8 times. If done correctly, you'll enter the debug menu. Here you're able to select the stage and area you want to begin on, as well as other options like hearts and money. Go to it! You know, it's been a long time since we did a review for a driving game, but then again, it's also been a long time since we did a review for a Sega Dreamcast game. Well, I got 2 words for you. Oh, will you grow up? Crazy Taxi! Hey, hey,
hey.
Driving has always been my favorite genre. These days, you can find me playing Need for Speed, Grand Theft Auto, or Mario Kart. But when I got my Dreamcast, Crazy Taxi was one of the games that was part of the auction. Yes, I was one of those people who missed out on the Dreamcast when it was first released. So you might say I'm making up for lost time by taking a look at what is said to be the second largest selling Dreamcast game in the US when it was released in 2000. Crazy Taxi sold 750,000 copies, and rightfully so. For those of you who don't know, Crazy Taxi for the Sega Dreamcast is a port of the arcade game which hit arcades in 1999. This is a score attack racing game where the object is simply to pick up passengers and take them to where they want to go in the fastest time. These passengers will stand around a colored circle. As long as your taxi is within that circle, the passenger will enter your vehicle. Oh, and by the way, the colors of the circle refer to the distance to the destination. If it's red, let's say, it'll be a quick and easy trip, and green means long, and so on. There'll be an arrow that will help you get to your passenger's destination. You're also given extra time once they get into your taxi. There's a few modes to this game. Arcade mode gives you the San Francisco map, while original mode adds an LA-themed city. There's also an option called Crazy Box, which will test your driving skills, of which I have none here. Now the two modes allow you to drive for 3, 5, or 10 minutes. If you select Arcade Rules, you have exactly a minute to get as many people as possible to their destination. That time can increase when you get them there fast enough. Be mindful of the timer above your passenger. That's how long you have to get them to where they need to go.
If the time runs out before you reach their destination, they'll jump out of your cab. Alright, you've probably noticed that I can't play this game worth a shit, can't drive to save my life, right? Well, you know what? I'm having a lot of fun with this game. Crazy Taxi has awesome graphics, superb color, and good animation. It's not without its graphical flaws here and there. Just bear in mind that it wasn't easy to port this game over because of the Dreamcast's lack of enough internal memory. On to the sound. You will hear a few hard rock and punk rock tunes with songs by bands like Bad Religion and Offspring. I don't mind the music much, but I turned it down a notch anyway. There's also a few repetitive voice clips, mainly coming from your passengers telling you to watch where you're going and yelling at you for your poor driving, which I did a lot of, thank you very much. This brings us to Control. Now, I caught a lot of shit from my first Dreamcast review a few years ago when I did San Francisco Rush 2049 and I griped about the Control, among other things. Look, I've got nothing against the trigger buttons being used to handle the acceleration and brake of my vehicle. I just don't want to. Maybe it's because I've been spoiled by the control scheme of the Mario Kart series. That being the case, I did alter my control setup in Crazy Taxi, and as you've seen, I still can't drive well. Maybe I apply too much pressure on the analog stick when I'm steering, and maybe I'm not applying enough. For now, I'll say the control issues are on my end, and it's not the game's fault. As for challenge, I can only get as far as a B ranking in the end. I've only experienced mild frustration, and I played another round and another. Despite the fact I crash into other cars, despite the fact I've only completed one out of, what, 9 minigames, I'll still power up my Dreamcast and take another crack at this game. Plus, I've got its sequel also for the Dreamcast, so expect a review to that in the near future. So my final verdict on Crazy Taxi is that it's a keeper.
Yeah, we'll be right there.
Hey!
I did my best.
You lousy driver!
everybody, it's Chris here, and it's launch day for the Nintendo 3DS, and I got one right here, so I figured I'd do a quick little unboxing. Alright, so here's the box itself. And, let's see how well I can do this, filming with one hand. Oh, great. There's these stickers. And luckily those came off pretty easy. And inside we have a giant packet of books. Talking about Mii Plaza. And I've got a bit of reading ahead of me. There's the AR cards there. You can see them in there. Those are for the augmented reality games. You can place them on your table or your friend's chest or whatever to have funny things pop out. You know, you could pretend things are popping onto your friend's chest and stuff like that. That's not just what you can do, but I guess that's what I'm thinking about. And this here is the 3DS. There it is. Welcome to the world. And let's see if I can pop this open without breaking it. There we are. Alright. So, I'm going to close that and see what else we have in here. Of course, we also have the charger. Takes the same charger as the DS Lite, so that's pretty cool. And this is the charging cradle, because the battery life is supposed to be not so great with the 3DS. They give you this little charger that you can, sit, you know, on your table. And just drop the thing in the dock, and it'll charge. Alright, so, that's what I've got here. So, hope you enjoyed that. Maybe in the future I can bring you some 2D versions of 3D video game reviews, who knows. Take care, have a good day.
Have you recently watched a film from the 70s, 80s, or even earlier and thought to yourself, if only I had seen this years ago? Well, it's happened to me too. It's not the first time, and I'm sure it won't be the last time. I guarantee you that I've missed out on a lot of great older films. The film that I'm talking about was released in 1984. It's called Cloak and Dagger, and this is my review. This film stars Henry Thomas, who you probably remember as Elliot from E.T. Here he plays Davy, a kid who immerses himself in the game Cloak and Dagger, which the film implies is a game playable on the Atari 5200. In reality, the scenes shown of the game being played are actually scenes from the arcade version of Cloak and Dagger. The 5200 version was never released due to the video game crash. Still, you can only imagine that somewhere, people most likely made a few inquiries to their local retail store asking for a video game that doesn't exist. Okay, there's your movie trivia. Let's continue with the characters and story. So, Davy escapes into the world of Cloak and Dagger to sort of help him cope with the loss of his mother and the absence of his father, played by Dabney Coleman. His father is too busy with work to spend time with Davy, so he creates his own little world of espionage and saves the world with the help of his imaginary friend, Jack Flack. No, not Jack Black, Jack Flack. Jack is the character from the Cloak and Dagger game who gives advice to Davy during their adventures. Interestingly enough, the imaginary version of Jack Flack resembles Davy's father, or rather, a more heroic version of him. Or maybe what Davy would like his father to be? In a movie like this, it's best to analyze it yourself. During one of Davy's espionage adventures with his friend Kim, Davy is witness to a murder.
Upon his death, the victim hands Davey a Cloak and Dagger cartridge, telling him to get it to the FBI. Apparently, this cartridge has secret military plans stored inside. Naturally, no one believes him, not the police or his father, so Davey enlists the help of his friend Morris, who works at a video game store. What happens then? My lips are sealed. Besides, I know how you guys feel about me spoiling the film or giving away too much of the plot. If you haven't seen this already, I can't recommend it enough. Much like the film The Wizard, which I reviewed a while back, the video game footage isn't quite accurate. Like I said earlier, the footage for the 5200 version of Cloak and Dagger was footage from the arcade version. I think that might have made this game more desirable by the video game community. Thinking that a home version could match an arcade version like that probably fooled a couple of Atari gamers. Talking about the film, I loved the story. If this film was done today, they'd probably make it all Home Alone with wacky antics and throw in a few fart jokes and such. Cloak and Dagger is for everyone. It gives you a story that's practically believable. Bad guys out to steal secret military plans? Yeah, could happen. Now the acting? Sometimes when child actors are involved, you're not sure what to expect. In this case, Henry Thomas really shines here. Hey, he was in E.T., remember? Also, Dabney Coleman playing Jack Flack is awesome. In Davey's mind, Jack Flack is invincible, unstoppable even. That's some imaginary friend, huh? Speaking of imaginary, I do have a small gripe about this film. If Jack Flack is imaginary, how is he able to open and close doors if he only exists in Davey's imagination? In some scenes, you see Jack grab hold of Davey. Was this a film error, or was it intentionally put in the script? Who knows? It's only a small gripe, so don't let it keep you from enjoying the movie. It's great for the whole family. Currently, you can stream this film off of Netflix. Now, before they take it off and replace it with something else, grab the spouse and kids, whip up some popcorn, and check out Cloak and Dagger. Well, here we are once again, bringing you some digs for March. Let's start things off with a new X-Men trailer. This is sort of a prequel to the original X-Men films with Professor Xavier and Magneto in their youth. No sign of Patrick Stewart or Ian McKellen or any of the original cast members. Yes, I know this is more of an origin story, but I think I'm going to pass on this one. But if you'd like to check out the trailer for yourself, a link will be provided. Another entry here is if video games had a super easy mode. We know that many classic video games weren't so easy to play back in the day, so the folks over at collegehumor.com whipped up this video showing you a few video games set to easy mode. You've got Legend of Zelda, Battletoads, Sonic the Hedgehog, and Mike Tyson's Punch-Out. A fantastic video, go have yourself a look. Speaking of Punch-Out, someone went through the trouble of creating a Mike Tyson's Punch-Out password generator. Now we all know how to get to Tyson, and we know a lot of secret passwords. But what if you wanted to create your own, and maybe choose your own fighting record and which circuit you want to start on? Well, now you can. We'll link you up for this one. Finally, this one is called Ultimate Retro Running Race, and features all your favorite video game characters like Sonic, Super Mario, Kirby, and more in a race to the finish line. This is very well animated, and you'll see a few obscure video game characters from Super Nintendo and Sega Genesis. You'll love how this one ends, but I ain't saying anything else. Go and check it out for yourself. That's going to do it for the Digital Dig for March 2011. All the videos you've seen can be viewed in their full glory by going to www.videomasterstv.com and check our forums for links. See ya!
I wait you. Riff. Yeah, you go. I'm gonna get you. Ooh, you better watch it. I'm gonna get you.
Don't mind me. I'm just taking a really objective look at this system, looking it over, looking at the various strengths and weaknesses, and hopefully in the future I'll be able to maybe give you some sort of professional summary of this system here. So why don't you go on ahead, and I will talk to you later. All right?
I'm gonna get your tail. I'm gonna get it. You better watch it.
I am through for today. Until next time. Adios, amigos. Or for whoever doesn't understand. Goodbye, motherfucker!
I don't think we can air that.
Just beep it.
It's a $7,000 machine. You press a button to get it.
$7,000 machine.